This morning, I have the incredible privilege to address the subject of, in essence, the definition of marriage from Scripture. I've entitled this morning's message, Is Same-Sex Marriage a Sin? This is a very relevant issue today, not just because of the LGBT issues that we face in the United States today, but in particular, due to the fact that the change that took place in the definition of what is legal as far as marriage goes in the United States last summer. Historically, the argument with regard to same-sex marriage and with regard to homosexuality and whether it's a sin or not has, to a large extent, been focused on whether the prohibition passages apply or not. Since last summer in particular, the argument has shifted in some respects to arguing about whether or not those prohibition passages apply, to discounting them outright, because those are talking about physical behavior between people of the same gender that are prohibited, but that's not what we have now. What we have, essentially for the first time in history, is legalized, monogamous, covenant relationships between people of the same sex. So the real question now is, if it's a lifetime commitment and it's a pure relationship just between those two individuals, does gender really still matter? Those prohibition passages talk about relations that are outside the covenant of marriage. But now we're talking about those who are legally married. So if it's monogamous, if it is pure in the context of one man and one woman, one woman for life, if it's a covenantal relationship, is it still sin? Because those prohibition passages then are all talking about relationships outside of that context. Now, for many of you, this may be a simple issue and a done deal. You may hold fast to the passages, and they will be covered in the rest of the sessions in this faculty lecture series. But for you, Leviticus 18, Romans 1 may be very clear. For you, Genesis 19, Leviticus 20, 1 Corinthians 6, and 1 Timothy 1 and verse 10 may be very clear. And all homosexual behavior and everything outside of the context of a marriage relationship is sin as far as physical relations. And so homosexuality is sin, and it's that simple. But you guys are training to be the next generation of men of God, and you need to be able to answer this issue biblically and fundamentally in a way that even demonstrates a familiarity with Scripture that can respond to the arguments that are given today. For some of you, this discussion may be one that that you think is a waste of time. I can remember when I was in classes with Nate, and before that, I remember also as part of my doctoral exams, I remember being compelled in OTI and OTI type exercises, as well as NTI, to go through and learn a lot of liberalism and a lot of the liberal views and mastering form criticism and all the different higher critical categories and all the big players. I remember memorizing all those old dead German names and saying, why do I want to know these guys? And it wasn't till later that I started to realize, you know, the issue really is that for the church, we just need to know the truth and be able to recognize error. But for an elder, according to 1 Timothy 3 and Titus 1, we need to be able to not only teach the truth, but be able to refute error. And the way you refute error is with the truth. And sometimes you need to be able to argue from that side as strong as possible and then bring Scripture to bear and give answers. That's what I would like to do for you this morning. With the legalization of same-sex marriage, we need to be able to give reasons because many today will argue that the prohibition passages related to homosexuality are referring to sinful same-sex relationships, not consensual monogamous relationships. And I want to address this subject from two perspectives. First, I want to take a few minutes and define and help you to define what God defines as sin. What does God define as sin? And then we'll take a look at the Genesis narrative and look at what God defines as marriage. Having done that, then, we'll be able to answer ultimately the question, is same-sex marriage a sin, even if it's consensual, even if it's monogamous? Now, how does God define sin? Well, there are a number of places throughout the scriptures that we could go. My two favorite texts are Psalm 51 and Psalm 32 from an Old Testament perspective. And that's because they're relating to a very clear and familiar sin or series of sins that was committed by David. You're familiar with David and the sins that he committed in taking Bathsheba, committing adultery, conspiring to cover it up, and then conspiring to have her husband Uriah murdered so that he could take her for himself. And I think we recognize a plurality of sins that David committed in that context. Psalm 51 is David writing a response or writing his own reaction to having been confronted by Nathan the prophet and having repented. The heading to the psalm even explains that this is a psalm by David when Nathan the prophet came into him after he had gone into Bathsheba. So this is how David responds in having been confronted in his plurality of sins. And he says this, "Be gracious to me, O God, according to your loving kindness, according to the greatness of your compassion, blot out my transgressions. Wash me thoroughly from my iniquity. Cleanse me from my sin." That's his request, having been confronted in his sin. And I do believe Psalm 32, also written by David, is a parallel to this, talking about the blessedness of forgiveness after he has repented and been restored in his relationship to God. And in fact, it reflects many of the things he learned from having sinned and experienced both repentance and forgiveness. And he says this, "How blessed is he whose transgression is forgiven, whose sin is covered. How blessed is the man to whom the Lord does not impute iniquity." And I think you heard those same three words both times. Trespass, sin, and iniquity. If you take those three terms and look at them individually and then build a composite from the basic definitions of those terms, and then if you were to elaborate on that by looking at, for example, even how David describes what forgiveness from those looks like and what his request for forgiveness looks like, I think you get a pretty good taste of what kinds of things can be defined scripturally as sin. The first word is trespass. Pesha is the Hebrew term. It is typically translated as either transgression or trespass. The root idea of that term is essentially to rebel against an authority, to cross a line, to commit a crime, to break a law, to do something forbidden by a higher authority. So it is when something is forbidden and you do it anyways, you've crossed a line, you've transgressed the law, you are a trespasser. That is one way that you can define sin. The second word is sin. The word is hata in the Hebrew. The verbal root basically means to miss the mark. It is a word used in reference to military contexts, referring to a slinger. And you know what a slinger is, right? It's before archery was really good, before the bows were really good, they would have a sling. And they would put a stone in it. And just like David took out Goliath, slingers would have their stones and they would twirl their sling and they would hit the target. Now, if they missed the target, that was the term hata. That was a sin. It would fall short of the target. It would be astray of the target. You would miss the mark. And if we step back for just a moment, we're very familiar with what David did, right? David, in a time when kings went off to war, 2 Samuel 11, David gets up from his bed at the end of the day, and he's He's out on his roof looking around, and he sees a woman bathing, and he immediately covets her. He immediately has a desire for her. He commits adultery with her in his heart and in his mind. He asks, who is this? He has her brought to him. He takes her for himself. When he is later told that she is pregnant, he has her husband sent home from the battlefront, tries to cover it up. When he fails in his effort to deceive what has happened and cover up his sin, he conspires to have him murdered. When he hears that he is dead, that her husband has been murdered, he takes her for himself. You can see a violation of you shall not commit murder, you shall not steal, commit adultery, covenant. David has transgressed the law a number of ways, right? And as a king, he has fallen short of what God expects in a number of ways. And those are two terms for sin. Now they're different, but you can see the synonymous nature between those two. What is the definition of a sin? It's when you fall short of God's perfect standard or when you do something that he forbids. Likewise, the term iniquity, awon, is the Hebrew word. And for me personally, this is the strongest word for sin. It looks at sin from the perspective not just of the offense itself, but it looks at it as an offense that deserves to be punished. It brings with it a guilt worthiness associated with having corrupted, perverted, or twisted what God originally intended. You did something, either to someone or in a relationship or with something or with yourself, that is a twisting or a corruption or a perversion of what God originally intended, and therefore it deserves to be punished. So when you put these three terms together and you ask the question, how does God define sin? God defines sin as anything that falls short of his perfect standard, anything that is an act of rebellion against his authority or twists his original intention and therefore deserves to be punished. And that is what God defines as sin. So when we talk about sin biblically, it isn't just doing things that are forbidden specifically in Scripture. It isn't even just about falling short of what God expects of us in any given context. It includes the guilt worthiness derived from any time we violate the original divine intention for God's creation or an aspect of his creation. It's bigger than just the rules that he has given. God doesn't have to give a specific, you shall not, and with all the clarifications in order for something to be a sin. Any violation or any twisting of the divine, expressed divine intention is a sin that deserves to be punished and to be punished eternally. Now, what about same-sex marriage if it's consensual? What about same-sex marriage if it's monogamous, like the biblical pattern? Is that a sin? Well, in order to answer this question, I think it's most appropriate and easiest just to go back to creation and look at how God defines marriage from the beginning. Let's take our Bibles now and turn to Genesis chapter 1. And you'll forgive me if I wind up being a little bit more of an expositor as opposed to a lecturer. I don't know how to give a lerman or a secture or whatever we did last year. But I do want to do an exposition of the bulk of Genesis 1 and 2 to help you to understand very clearly how God has defined marriage from the beginning. We will start in Genesis 1 with the first reference to the creation of man and woman. Genesis 1, starting in verse 26. We're in creation week. We're in day 6. Verse 26 tells us, then God said, let us make man in our image, according to our likeness, and let them rule over the fish of the sea and over the birds of the sky and over the cattle and over all the earth and over every creeping thing that creeps on the earth. So God created man in his own image. In the image of God, he created him. Male and female, he created them. Now, this is not a direct reference to marriage per se. I get that. I understand that. The further elaboration and explanation of marriage is in Genesis chapter 2. But there are several aspects of this opening statement that are essential to recognize. Number one is that God created man in his image, and that includes both men and women. So when you're talking about being an image bearer of God, you are an equal bearer of God's image, whether you are male or female. There are gender distinctives, and I understand the term gender. You can make a distinction grammatically and in other contexts between gender and sex. I'm just going to use the term gender to refer specifically to male and female for the sake of this discussion. There are gender distinctives that are part of the original creation. God made a man and he made a woman to be the original couple. And that original couple had gender distinctives, but they were both equal bearers of God's image. In your theology classes, this is ontologic equality. They were ontologically equal. They were equal in their person, equal in their being, equal in who they are in the sight of God. Men and women are both created equally in God's image. So they're both just as important to God, and they're both fully manifestations of who God is and what he's like within his creation. Now, if you will look in verse 28, you'll see that we're told that he blessed them. God blessed them, the man and the woman together. God blessed them, and God said to them, "Be fruitful and multiply, fill the earth and subdue it, and rule over the fish of the sea and over the birds of the sky and over every living thing that moves on the earth." Now, I want you to see that this is the first set of divine commandments and instructions that God gives to mankind. This is, in a sense, the mandate. It involves procreation. It involves filling the earth. But it also includes subduing it and ruling over it. Procreation is part of the mandate that God gives to this initial couple. That's not the totality of it, though. It is that coupled with filling it, coupled with subduing it, coupled with ruling it. And this is to both the man and the woman together. This is the mandate from God to mankind in his place in the created order. The uniqueness of the gender specificity is not just a matter of procreation. The way that God created man and woman to be the first couple necessarily requires gender distinction to involve procreation, but the totality of the mandate for those two goes beyond that. And incidentally, if you look at verse 31, God, at the conclusion of the creation week, sees all that he has made, and behold, it is now tov me'od. It is very good. And there was evening and there was morning the sixth day. So at the conclusion of creation week, God looks at everything, the totality of the creation that he has made, and he evaluates it all as exactly the way he wants it. It's interesting, when you go back through the creation week, six times God looks at the state of creation at that point, and he saw that it was good, he saw that it was good, he saw that it was good. Why would you have the echo of "he saw that it was good" recurrent as a theme throughout creation week? Because it's a very definitive way to say, at each step along the way, when God stopped and evaluated it up to this point, there was no flaw. There was no fatal flaw. Now, it wasn't done. It wasn't exactly and totally the way he wanted it yet, but there wasn't anything that was wrong. There was, any of you guys ever work in the computer industry? Ever write a program and you test it and you find over time there are bugs in it? There were no bugs in the original creation. When you get to Genesis chapter 3 and you're going, "Well, if God made such a perfect creation, what happened?" Okay? The responsibility for the fall is on man, not on God. That's why there's the echo of "it's good, it's good, it's good." When you get to the end, it's very good, it's perfect, it's exactly the way I want it, there's nothing wrong with it. It's flawless. Now, when you get to Genesis chapter 2, now we're going to get further into the actual details about what God did when he created man, and later that same day created woman, the sixth day of creation. And we'll skip down to verse 15. Then the Lord God took the man. Well, actually, we'll start in verse 7. The Lord God formed the man of dust from the ground, breathed into his nostrils the breath of life, and man became a living being. Now, this is a further elaboration of what we were told in Genesis chapter 1. We're now being told that God personally formed the man from dust from the ground. He personally fashioned him into the shape, the form of an individual that he wanted him to manifest. And then he breathed into his nostrils the breath of life, and man became a living being, a living soul. Skipping to verse 15, then the Lord God took the man, put him into the Garden of Eden to cultivate and keep it. The Lord God commanded the man, saying, from any tree of the garden you may eat freely, but from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil you shall not eat from it, for in the day that you eat from it, you will surely die. So there is the exercise of divine authority and saying there are requirements and expectations, and if you eat from this tree, you will incur a penalty, and it's a death penalty. And then the amazing thing happens in verse 18, and this really relates to what we're talking about now. Then the Lord God said, it is not good for the man to be alone. I will make him a helper suitable for him. That not good should really catch your attention. It is the first time that God has evaluated any aspect of his creation as not good. Six times in the Genesis 1 account, God saw that it was good, God saw that it was good, God saw that it was good. We even know at the end of the 6 days, he looks at everything and now it's very good. But there was a point on the sixth day when God evaluated something as not good. And you know what that thing was? It was not good for the man to be alone. This is the divine evaluation. Incidentally, this is what tells you that it is God himself who recognized that there was a need here. He recognized and indeed identifies that there is something missing up to this point in his creation that he intends to do. This isn't Adam going through the day and saying, hey, you know what, Lord? I've noticed that every other creature has a companion. I would like one. Or don't you think I ought to have one? It isn't the man who identifies his need or chooses his companion. It is God who, even before the demonstration of man's need through the naming of the animals comes up, it is God himself who articulates, we're not done yet. There's something missing. It is not good for the man to be alone. I will make him an ezer kenegdo. I will make him a helper suitable for him. Now that little phrase, a helper suitable for him. Most of the time when I'm preaching through a text like this or making reference to this text, most of the time the focus is on that first word, ezer, helper. Because in today's contemporary culture, and as long as I can remember, and unlike Dr. Essex, I wasn't part of the 60s except as an infant. So actually, I wasn't part of the generation that messed everything up. sorry, that was for Dr. Boozness. But I am part of the generation that immediately comes on the heels of that. And as long as I can remember, there have been issues still about race and about sex and about gender and about feminism and about. And typically, when I'm in a church context and I get to this passage that talks about, I will make him an ezer kenegdo, a helper suitable for him, the term helper comes across to begin with to women as offensive because somehow that makes her lesser. Do you know the term ezer, the term helper, is most often applied in Scripture to God? Do you know the number one helper in the Bible? It's God. Psalm 46:1. God is our refuge and strength, a very present help or a very present helper in times of trouble. Do you know the simple fact that you are the helper implies that the other person has a need, needs to be assisted? See, when God made the woman, he made her ontologically equal. He made her an equal person, an equal bearer of God's image. But he made her economically subordinate. He made her functionally distinct to be the one that is the helper as opposed to the head, because headship by itself is insufficient. There is the need for both. That's why God says it's not good for man to be alone. Both the man and the woman, the husband and the wife, are equal in importance, equal in being in the sight of God. And they're equally key and integral to a functioning marriage relationship. The roles are different, but neither one is more important than the other. And that is a principle you can derive very clearly, I think, from Genesis 1. And then when you relate it here into Genesis chapter 2, you can see the role distinction being defined. Now, the argument then goes from same-sex marriage that is consensual and monogamous. Well, but since we're at a point where the earth is filled or near to being filled, and since the whole idea of a family can be derived from adoption or in vitro fertilization or whatever else, since we're in that situation, can't a guy be a helper to a guy or a gal be a helper to a gal? Well, I guess you could say that. I would suggest that if you look at the distinctions in gender that are part of the original created order, I think you would find that the gender distinction makes a woman particularly suited to be the helper, and not the helper to another woman, but the helper to the man who is her husband. I think there are marvelous aspects of feminism, of being a woman. I got a lot to cover, and I'm trying to get it all in. I think there are aspects to being a woman that just make her the perfect complement to a man. Some of the inherent natural aspects of my wife as a woman gives her a different perspective than what I have, and vice versa. I do think the gender specificity includes a lot of things that might be argued are subjective that make that companionship far superior to two of the same gender. But the biblical argument foundationally for gender distinction is in the word kenegdo. This term is a little bit more difficult to define with specificity. Suitable is the English translation in many of your translations. It's a compound word that literally could be translated as a helper according to him, or a helper like him, but face-to-face complement with him. It's the idea of exact complementary correspondence, a face-to-face complement. Now, some have argued that this is primarily talking about procreation and biology, and that the way that complementation works. I would go back and say it's bigger than that, because the mandate that's given in Genesis chapter 1 includes not just procreation and filling the earth, but also subduing and ruling over it. That complementary relationship, the uniqueness of a woman as the helper who is the perfect complement to her husband, is bigger than just the ability to procreate, but it includes that. It is a helper that exactly corresponds to him. And that's where the idea of suitable comes from. We'll even see in the next verses that Adam does not find an exact correspondence to himself among any of the other living creatures. What he recognizes is that he has a need for a living creature that exactly corresponds to himself in a face-to-face kind of relationship with someone who is created to help him in fulfilling the divine commission, to complete him. Casuto describes it this way. It means a helper like him, suited to him, and worthy of him. Excuse me. And I like that last one the best. One who is truly not just suited to him, but who is worthy of him. Someone who is an equal bearer of God's image and yet the perfect complement in all the needed ways to him. And what is she created to help with? It is not simply childbirth, although that is part of it. It's all the aspects of the divine mandate. So God has identified man's need. Now he's going to demonstrate man's need to man. Verse 19, out of the ground the Lord God formed every beast of the field and every bird of the sky and brought them to the man to see what he would call them or name them. And whatever the man called a living creature, that was its name. In Genesis chapter 1, the only individual who's been naming anything is God. And that naming, the light he called day and the darkness he called night, etc., that naming is an exercise of authority. For the first time, he is bestowing that right to exercise authority to someone else, and he bestows that authority on man. And he parades the creatures in front of man, and man goes through and he names them. He exercises authority. This is right in keeping with what you see at the end of Genesis 1 being the mandate that God gives to man, that he is to rule over all the living creatures. So, the creatures are brought forward, the man names them. And one of the grand object lessons that man is to discern here is that as he sees this host of living creatures, and he names them all and recognizes their unique, distinct abilities and functions and appearances, etc. He names each one in accordance with their character, their nature, their appearance. And as he does this, he cannot help but notice that all come forward with suitable companions. All come forward with a mate, with a complement, which facilitates not just procreation, it also facilitates them serving in their capacities. And the lesson then is that man needs a suitable helper. Not one of the other creatures are qualified. Many are able to aid man and serve man, but there is no equal to man that is found. No true correspondence to man is available. While they too were made by God and from out of the ground, while they too are living creatures made up of the same basic elements of earth, not one is truly suitable as man's aser conigno. For the record, man's best friend is not a dog. It isn't even to be found amongst any of the other living creatures that God has made. Man's best friend is woman, his equal and perfect complement in every way. Verse 20, so the man gave names to all the cattle, to the birds of the sky, to every beast of the field, but for Adam there was not found a suitable helper for him, or a helper suitable for him. And it's very strong in the Hebrew here. You've got a very strong adversative, but for Adam there wasn't found an aser conigno. Now, let's take a look at how God meets man's need. Verse 21, so the Lord God caused a deep sleep to fall upon the man, and he slept. And then he took one of his ribs and closed up the flesh at that place. It always tickles me when people get into the whole discussion about, did Adam have a rib missing, etc. The word rib here is actually just referring to the side. So, if you wanted to be literal, he took a chunk of his side. Well, where's the idea of a rib come from? Well, later on, Adam is going to say, now this is bone of my bones and flesh of my flesh. Essentially, what God did was he put Adam to sleep and took a chunk out of the man and closed it up. And out of that chunk then, God made a woman. Now, why does he do that? Why did the Lord God fashion into a woman the chunk, the rib, which he had taken from man? Why did he do that? Why doesn't he just go get some dirt and make a compliment? Because it is a very, very direct way to show not only equality of persons, both were made by God, both were made from exactly the same substance. Woman is part of man. We are equal in being, in person, and even in the material that we're made from. We are equal in the sight of God. We're still distinct. There is gender distinction. If you're married, you're very familiar with the differences between men and women in personality, in mood, in discernment, in experience, in perspective. Would you agree with that? Yeah, your wife has a different perspective than you do. Would you assent to that? Yeah, and you have a different perspective than she has. Would you agree? Listen, that's a good thing. The only reason it's not always a good thing and an enjoyable thing in our marriages today is because of sin. We both have a sin nature. One of the little wake-up calls in the context of premarital counseling, and then you marry the couple, and they walk out with their rose-colored glasses, and boy, he is just the most godly husband that she has ever seen and can't wait to be married and just loves being married to him. And he is the most godly, the most humble, the most gracious leader. I look forward to submitting to him all the rest of my days. And then you have the white dresses and the rose petals. And are you sure you're going to do that? You sure you want? Okay, well, kiss the bride and Mr. and Mrs. And 6 weeks later, Pastor, I married a sinner. Yeah, well, so did your spouse. The distinctions, though, are God-given. They're unique. They're good things. It's what makes a marriage. The different perspectives, the different roles, the different functions, and the way that we're created and given to those roles. Well, yeah, well, some of the arguments that come down is, well, my wife's smarter than me, so I just follow what she says. Well, that's not biblical. Why not? Because that's not what God says. If she's smarter than you, you should be leveraging her opinion a lot, but you don't abdicate headship. God took from a chunk of the man and fashioned an azer kenigdo for him. And he brought him to the man. And notice the response of the man. Notice his enthusiasm, his excitement, his thrill. This now is bone of my bones and flesh of my flesh. This is my complement. Excuse me. This is someone who is equal to me and perfectly matched with me. She shall be called woman because she was taken out of man. These are the first recorded words, human words, in all of redemptive history. Did you know that? The very first statement any human being makes that is recorded in Scripture is, this is bone of my bones and flesh of my flesh. It's a rejoicing over the perfect companion that God has made him and one who is truly equal to him. In verse 24, and we'll go ahead and answer Dr. Essex's exegetical question for you guys that I hope you did your homework over the weekend. For this reason. This is a key phrase in Genesis. It indicates a statement of explanation for the sake of the reader. This is God through the pen of Moses giving an explanation that is derived from what you've just read. For this reason, it isn't Adam saying this. This is God through Moses explaining. This is what marriage is and what it's like and the way and why the beginning of marriages is going to work like this. For this reason, because God said it's not good for the man to be alone, because God made from the side of the man a perfect complement, a woman, because of this, a man shall leave his father and mother, shall be joined to his wife, and they shall become one flesh. That's the definition of marriage. a man leaves his father and mother. Incidentally, you'll notice there is no reference to the woman leaving her father and mother. Why is that? Is it because he leaves his family and joins hers? No. Is it because he leaves his family and she stays with hers? No. It's because he leaves his family and establishes a new household, and she just transfers from under the authority of her father to the under the authority of her husband. This is gender specific. This is the definition of marriage and the way God ordains marriage to be. A man grows up, matures, exits from underneath the authority of his parents, and establishes a new household and brings his wife underneath that authority. That's God's plan for marriage. That's what God has defined marriage to be. And the man and his wife were both naked, and they were not ashamed. This is the way it is, not because of sin. This is the way it is, not just because it's necessary for procreation. This is the way it is because that's the way that God created it, because those two bearers of God's image were created with gender specificity and role functional subordination, created to be that kind of a complementary companion. Now, let's ask the question, is same-sex marriage a sin? Even if it's consensual, legal, and monogamous? The answer is yes. Number one, the original creation was a pair with gender distinctions. Number two, procreation was part, but only part, of the original mandate. See, the original mandate encompassed not just procreation, filling the earth, but also subduing and ruling over it. And the gender specificity is part of that gender specificity is part of that function as well. Number three, aser kenigdo involves more than mere role distinctions. It is a specifically created complementary distinction that includes everything from procreation to relationship management and everything else that's given in the mandate there. Number four, the definition of marriage in Genesis 2 and verse 24 affirms that this is to be the way marriage is. A man leaving his household, joined to his wife, and the two becoming one flesh. Incidentally, that also defines polygamy as a sin. It is two, not a plurality. And I will throw in one more. I believe the New Testament confirms this, and I'm sure we'll get into this more in the weeks to follow, but if you were to take your Bible and look with me at Matthew 19. Now, I could go to Ephesians 5 and talk about the role distinctions and how those role distinctions are given, etc., but we'll just take a look at Matthew 19. In verse 3, Pharisees come to Jesus, and they're seeking to test him. So they're trying to find fault with him. They don't really care about the answer. They just want to find him saying something wrong they can use as leverage against him. But notice the question. They say, is it lawful for a man to divorce his wife for any reason at all? And he answers and says to them, have you not read that he who created them from the beginning made them what? Male and female. Now that's interesting. Because I don't need to say that to answer this objection. I don't have to make any reference to male and female. All I really need to answer that question, if I'm Jesus, is verse 5. And say, for this reason a man shall leave his father and mother, shall be joined to his wife, and the two will become one flesh. What God has joined together, nobody's to take apart. God has made marriage to be a one-flesh relationship. He doesn't have to make any reference to male and female. Why does he make reference to male and female? Why does he go not first back to Genesis 2, but all the way back to Genesis 1? Because male and female is the definition of marriage. That is the first statement about marriage. even if it's not explicitly saying this is a marriage. And what's more, when he says, for this reason a man shall leave his father and mother and shall be joined to his wife, and the two will become one flesh, he's quoting from Genesis 2 prior to the fall, saying this is still the way it is even after the fall. Things haven't changed. God's standard hasn't changed. So as a result, they're no longer two but one flesh, and what God has therefore joined together, no one is to separate. Divorce is wrong because it's contrary to what God has originally ordained marriage to be, male and female, one of each in a one-flesh relationship for life. That's the definition of marriage according to Scripture. And I believe Ephesians 5, for example, when Paul makes a reference to the same Genesis 2 passage, he's defining the roles being what they are on that basis. At the end of the day, and listen to me, this is why anything other than a one man, one woman, one flesh relationship as the definition of marriage is sin. And this is why any physical intimate relationship outside of the context of a one flesh biblical marriage relationship is sin. This is why adultery is sin. This is why fornication is sin. This is why homosexuality is sin. But we love each other and we're going to get married, but you're not married. So it's sin because it's outside of the context of what God has defined. So it's iniquity. It deserves to be punished because you're twisting what God has designed to your own ends. But we're better companions than my wife and I. So it's adultery. It's sin. In fact, in that case, you are transgressing a specifically stated law. You're falling short of God's perfect standard. You're violating the law. And you're committing iniquity, which makes you guilty and deserving of eternal punishment. Is same-sex marriage a sin, even if it's consensual, legal, and monogamous? Yes, because it's contrary to what God ordained marriage to begin with. Now, I know I'm not supposed to be the pastor today, but I want to throw in one more word, because in my 17 years of pastoral ministry at Roosevelt Community Church and the years I spent here at Grace and the years I spent at Clear Creek before, I have learned that this is a real issue that people in your churches need to know and you need to know. And you need to be able to explain that homosexuality is sin and why it's sin. And at the same time, you need to do it in such a way where you're not treating that as the unpardonable sin. You're not treating people in these contexts as the unforgivable pariahs that a lot of hyper-conservative society treats them as. Jesus did not hesitate to sit down with tax collectors and sinners and invite them into his kingdom. He made repentance the requirement, but he didn't hesitate to sit down and talk to them about their sin and invite them and offer them a place in his kingdom if they turned from their sin. He also did not hesitate to sit down with Pharisees and scribes in their religious legalism and call them to repentance as well. Yeah, we need to be able to give an answer to the fact that same-sex marriage is sin because it's contrary to what God defined marriage to be from the beginning. But we need to do it in a way that compels people to repent and invites people into the kingdom, not pronounces them outright as eternally judged forever because they've committed the worst sin imaginable. And I would echo what you heard last week. For us as Christians, we don't need a new Supreme Court. We need to be a faithful generation of Christian expositors who preach the truth and call sinners to repentance. Father, thank you for today and for your kindness in so many ways. Thank you for the forgiveness of sins that you have given to me and to all of us who have come in repentance and faith to you. Indeed, I would echo with the Apostle Paul. The more I know about me and about my heart and about my life, and the more I see the standard you've recorded for us in Scripture and revealed to us in your Word, the more I do see that I am the chief of sinners. May we indeed all gain a level of appreciation of ourselves as a chief sinner in order that we might be a useful instrument in sharing Christ and the love of the gospel of Jesus Christ to those who are lost around us, regardless of what sins they're committing. In Jesus' name, amen.